Good evening, everybody. I am Dr Prem. I am Interventional Cardiologist and Electrophysiologist in Mayo Hospital, Chennai. I know I am the junior most in this gathering. I am seeing few of my professors also here. I am here to present about device therapy in management of congestive heart failure. Next. Conventionally, the management of heart failure is basically medicine. And previously, we were treating with digoxin and diuretics, and then came. But how much mortality can be improved based on these drugs alone? And we have data. Not more than 20% improvement in relative mortality reduction can be achieved by all these drugs. Together with these drugs, you can maximum reduce the mortality relatively by 25% only. The data are there. And then came the advent of the cardiac desynchronization therapy. The object of cardiac desynchronization therapy is that there is a desynchrony element in patients who are what is brought up QRS in the ECG. And if you captivate the desynchrony element by putting another leaf on the left ventricular side, make the RV and LV contract simultaneously, you can achieve the improvement in ejection fraction. So the mortality reduction is not just achieved by reduction in the number of hospitalizations in patients with cardiac desynchronization therapy. They achieved a real reduction in ejection fraction, reduction in left ventricular systolic volume, reduction in the heart size. That is how they improve the mortality. So now let us go into the next. So what is biventricular pacing? It's always called the cardiac desynchronization therapy. If there is a ventricular desynchrony, what do you mean by ventricular?
Turn the mic.
What do you mean by ventricular desynchrony? There is an abnormal ventricular conduction which results in a mechanical delay and asynchronous contraction. It is called ventricular desynchrony. Next slide. You can see on the right side of the picture, there is a relatively normal ventricle. The left side of the picture, it is the abnormal ventricle. You can see the QRS is narrow. The QRS is narrow on the right side of the picture, the QRS is broad on the left side of the picture. And the septal contraction is actually out of phase to the lateral wall contraction in this picture, on the left side of the picture. That is the patient who has got the complete left ventricular blast block. This patient will definitely reap some benefits from the cardiac desynchronization therapy. Next slide. Next. So, how do you achieve this? Basically, we put a lead in the right atrium and we put a lead in the right ventricular side of septum. And one more lead we take through the coronary sinus and put it in the posterior lateral left ventricular vein on the left ventricular side. Why can't we put a lead into the left ventricular chamber itself? So we can put, but the problem with the left ventricular chamber is they can form clots and the clot can embolize and produce flow. So that is why we take the left ventricular lead onto the epicardial side of this left ventricular chamber. On the epicardial left ventricular chamber itself, we have the coronary venous tributary cells. We can take it very nicely there. Next slide. So what are the indications for cardiac desynchronization therapy? Patient who has got congestive cardiac failure, whose symptoms are not controlled with maximal medical therapy. Maximal medical therapy, I mean all those drugs which improve the mortality. This ACE inhibitors, ARBs, angiotensin receptor, aldosterone blockers and beta blockers. And the ejection fraction should be less than 35%. And there is evidence of electrical conduction delay. The evidence of electrical conduction delay is conventionally and now also it is indicated only by the complete left ventral branch block. That means greater than 120 milliseconds QRS duration. What are the fallacies of the left ventral branch block or the duration of QRS alone taking as the indication for CRT? I will tell you later. So, and the more important is timing of referral of the patient. The patient cannot be referred at 15 or 20% ejection fraction. Already the muscles have gone and it has become fibrous. And you do a CRT in such a patient, you will achieve very, very minimal improvement in ejection fraction. And the patient will not improve much actually. So, the proper referral should be very early actually. So coming to short about the procedure about the cardiac desynchronization therapy, here you are seeing the AP view of the coronary venous sinus anatomy. So on the right of the picture we have coronary venous sinus anatomy which is taken with the Schwann-Ganz that is put well inside the coronary venous sinus. And whatever you are seeing the vein, here, this is the posterior lateral vein of the left ventricle. This is the vein which is targeted. This vein will be exactly laying on the posterior lateral side of the left ventricle. So you target this vein, take a lead into that vein and then connect to the CRT, then you will activate the latest part of the left ventricle in this patient. Next. And this is RAO view of the same. Next. Hello, previous, go to the previous picture. So whatever your lead you are seeing, this one, this lead is the right ventricular apical lead. This will represent the septal contraction. Septal contraction can be represented with the lead. Now we are going to take the lead into the left ventricular side of the left ventricular side. Next. And this is the LAO picture of the same. Left postal lateral vein is very big, postal lateral vein is seen nicely. Next. Next. There is a lateral vein, which is the best suited vein for the left ventricular vein. Next. Another view, next. Okay. So we have got enough data to say that the mortality is reduced very well with the cardiac incident in therapy with or without the implantable cardioverter defibrillator. So these are all the contemporary trials which have clearly denoted that with or without ICD CRT will improve the mortality. I don't want to go too much into those details, but those most of the trials, the ejection fraction is less than 85%, and they are all in class 3 and class 4 ejection fraction patients. Next. Coming to effect of CRT on composite response. Composite response, I mean not only the mortality reduction, it is decrease in the number of hospitalizations, decrease in the functional class of the patient. Those are all called composite response. You can see when compared to control, CRT patients have improved 67%, and in the patient with CRT also, when you take this indication, there are 17% of patients who had produced no change, and there are 16% of patients who had worsened actually with the CRT. Why is that? I will tell you this. Next slide. It is because of poor patient selection when you are taking the patient. How to improve the selection of the patient? We have to move beyond the pure aspiration, not just left ventricular mass block. When you see a patient who has got LV dysfunction, you will have to immediately send the patient for dyssynchrony echo. If the patient QR is greater than 120 milliseconds, there is no doubt the patient, we can say, the patient, most 90% of patients will have dyssynchrony. So these patients will benefit from medical CRT. But when the patient has narrow QRS and the patient has LV dysfunction, we should think beyond that. This patient may have dyssynchrony and this patient may also benefit from CRT. We should think about that. Next. So this is a very elegant slide actually. You can see on the left side of the slide there is less than 120 milliseconds QR saturation, and the right side of the slide is greater than 150 milliseconds QR saturation. If there is less than 130 milliseconds QR saturation, we can see this is the no dyssynchrony. When you go beyond like this, it is maximum dyssynchrony. Now there is less than 120 milliseconds QR, dyssynchrony will be very well met. And patients who are maximum dyssynchrony is only 18%. When it is greater than 150, the dyssynchrony is, the patient without dyssynchrony is very less. Patient who has dyssynchrony is maximum. That is the idea of the selecting greater than 120 milliseconds QR duration for selecting a patient for CRT. But you can see clearly that in less than 120 milliseconds duration also, there are 18% of patients who have dyssynchrony. And greater than 150 milliseconds, there is 20% of patients who does not have dyssynchrony. So we have to send a patient for dyssynchrony assessment even if the QRS is less than 120 milliseconds. That is what this slide says. So now the dyssynchrony can be assessed with a lot of imaging modalities, not just echo. The baseline echo with the MOT has gone beyond that. This is called tissue Doppler imaging. You can see in pre and post CRT, the phase of contraction is same. Like, if I have a pointer, I can tell you. The yellow arrow shows that the point which is contracting is little late in the lateral wall. Now it is contracting simultaneously. On the right side, after the CRT, all the signals are contracting simultaneously. That is what it means. Next. For selecting a patient for CRT, you can take a CT help also. Conventionally, CT only, you know, the structures can be seen in the CT, but it is not like. Now there is functional CT where you can assess the contraction of the left ventricle, and you can know which part is contracting early, which part is contracting late. Other than that, the CT will help you to say, show where is the venous sinus anatomy, which vein you can select. Next slide. This is a good slide. The middle part of the slide shows there is one blue patch in the middle slide. That is the functional CT. The blue patch shows there is scar. And the other patch, the other part of the blue patch shows scar, the other part of the is viable myocardium. And this is the latest part of the left ventricular contraction. This is the earlier part of contraction. But with this, we can see, in this CT, we can see this sort of card actually. When you put a lead here, even if it is latent subarachnoid segment, when you put a lead here, because of our scar, the patient will not pace and will not improve. So you have to put a lead here. That is how CT will help you to assess, select the patient for CRT. Next slide. So again, MRI, we have a functional MRI. With what all things which can be seen in CT can be seen in MRI also. Additionally, MRI can tell you with the late cardiogram enhancement, MRI can tell you where is the scar exactly, extent of scar. Whether the scar is only for part of thickness of myocardium or it is full thickness of myocardium, those things can be told elegantly by MRI rather than CT. There are trials, MARI-2 and MARI-2. These two trials have dealt with patients with class 1 and class 2 heart failure. That is what is the trend of CRT now. Previously, they were referring very sick patients for CRT, like class 3 and class 4 patients. Those patients, before taking the patient for CRT, we will have to give dopamine infusion, give them diuretics, we have to be worried about the kidney, those things. But now, if we can send the patient early to us, we are in a better position to put the patient on CRT, and the patient's outcome also is easier, better. So, they have studied class 1 and class 2 patients with MARI-2 and miraculously. They have got miraculous, the composite endpoint has improved phenomenally. Next. This is a 3D perspective. We have a 3D rotational angiogram lab in our main hospital where you can with a single shot of angio, you can see RAO and LAO, both orthogonal use you can see in single shot. Patient with renal dysfunction, you can use only one shot of dye to assess both the veins, both the veins. Again, this is a dysentery 3D, with a 3D echo, how can you assess the dysentery? This magnetic navigation system at present is present only in Massachusetts Hospital in the US. But this system is used, it will allow you to take wire everything without neuro guidance. Without neuro, you can take the wire everything with a magnetic navigation system. Next slide. See, if you cannot take the lead into the coronary sinus, this happens at least in 10% of patients, we will not be able to take the lead into the coronary sinus and to the vein. Those times, we will ask the surgeon's help. The surgeon will open the two lateral phlebotomy and go into the part and screw the lead and give it to us in the pocket. You can easily connect it. This need not be done only by open the phlebotomy. There are robotic navigation systems where you have to just put a ventricular assisted video assisted tricuspid surgery. Just 3 ports, you can take the lead inside and you can do it. Next slide. This is a robotically assisted LV lead system, LV lead implantation. Next slide. Previously, we had only one straight lead which will go on, it will, we will be worried until 1 week, until we get 5 doses, the lead will come back or not, we will be worried really. But now there are lot of bends in the lead, lot of curves, and we have lead fixation system along with the along the length of the lead, times of them, so that you just put the lead and plug it, it will never come out. Next. And the CRT does not stop with pacing electrode, it also will assess the impedance across the chest. So it will know before the patient develops into thoracic cardiac failure, like if there is pulmonary venous hypertension, pulmonary edema. The device here will assess the impedance across the chest. If the impedance rises, it will tell you that there is a fluid accumulating in the lung and the patient will require more airway. That is what it will say. So there are devices now, it is there in Tenjuru, there is called Unify One device system. It will give alarms, if the pulmonary cavity patient grows, it will give alarms. So, technology has grown so much. CRT and I3 implantation does not end with implantation. You may know that CRT, how to implant a CRT, you can get away by just implanting it. I3 also, I3 is just a pacemaker implantation, guy who knows pacemaker can do I3 also. But the problem does not stop there, the problem actually starts there. Patients who get the implanted I3 or who get implanted CRTD, these patients, if they get an inappropriate shock or inappropriate pacing, then you should know how to interrogate. Most of our physicians, including our colleagues, they leave the interrogation to the technicians. They know how to assess the threshold, how to assess the impedance, those things only. How to play with those things, because they are like smartphones. There are a lot of applications in those. If you get a programmer on the pacemaker, you know a lot of applications. So, we also should know, the researcher who implanted should know in and out 1 to 100 of the applications involved in it, how to make the best use of it, and how to troubleshoot also should know. Actually, problems start after implanting ICD. you know, when the patient comes and says, I have 100 inappropriate shocks, then you are gone. So if you don't know how to manage it, then what is the point in implanting it? That is cell phone. Next. There are options in the pacemaker itself how to optimize the atrial ventricular and interventricular delay and to make the best use of the CRT. So the LV function can improve and the diastole improve and the patient functional class will improve. These are all the ways we can assess. Yeah, these are all Ritter's formula. It is very difficult to. These are all software related and it is easy to understand logically, but it will take a long time. This is not the scope of this speak now. So, I tell you a few clinical examples. I tell you how optimization of ventilation will improve a patient's functional class. Next. This gentleman, Mr. X, after implantation of CRT for complete heart block with LV dysfunction, this gentleman came to me with functional class 2 dysmionization. Dysmionization did not improve. What happened was, one of our friends has left it to the technician for optimizing the AV delay to the patient. So what the technician will do is, he will just put a empirical AV delay of 140 milliseconds, he will just set it and left it. Next slide. I'll show you what happens if the patient's AV delay was 150 milliseconds. If the patient's AV delay was kept at 150 milliseconds, this is the diastole of the heart. Vital lymph node, doctor, you can see only E is in, there is no AV at all, because the AV is hidden inside the E. And so the patient will develop severe pulmonary venous hypertension, because your mitral valve is contracting against the, your left atrium is contracting against the closed mitral valve. So the patient will develop severe pulmonary venous hypertension. Next slide. What I did was I shortened the AV delay. Then you see that after the AV, the AV has come out now. So now the atrium is contracting against the open mitral valve. The patient, I tell you, when I did it, the patient said, told me, sir, I felt something is released in my chest. Patient told me this. So that is how you improve the patient's functional class by taking the programming also into consideration, not just implanting it. Next slide. This is the intra-atrial delay. For example, from the right atrium to left atrium, the conduction delay is actually 62 milliseconds. If there is greater than 62 milliseconds, then what happens is, you are implanting the lead only in right atrium. You don't have a lead in left atrium. How does the left atrium, right atrial, right atrium to right ventricle will contract again, right atrium to left ventricle? That is not the correct one. Because you have to have a timing for right atrium to right ventricle and left atrium to left ventricle. You cannot put a timing for right atrium and then ask them to ask right atrium to contract against the left ventricle. That will be delay. If there is an interatrial delay, then this will become a real problem. You have to take into account the interatrial delay also while programming the AV delay. So, one of the few patients, next slide. This is one of the patients where you can see. In the mitral lymph node Doppler, the EVA and AVA is not very separate, but the tricuspid lymph node Doppler is just normal. That means there is an interatrial delay between right atrium and left atrium. So, what happens next slide? See, AVA is truncated then. Next slide. Next slide. What I did was, I increased the AV delay a little 40 milliseconds longer. Next slide. His intra-atrial delay is better and his AV delay was very optimal for the left ventricle. Left atrium to left ventricle contraction was very optimal, only the AV delay is kept longer than the right atrial ventricle. Next slide. So, subsequently, the patient did 330 meters on 6 minute walkers, became asymptomatic on routine activity. I know this is very difficult to understand. I wanted to cut short because I have to stop here before 20 minutes. Next.
Running out of time, sir.
Next slide. These are all know how to assess the interval. Next slide. Coming to inappropriate ICD shocks, because that is also a part of the difference. Inappropriate ICD shock is the one when the patient gets the shock for ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation. If the patient gets the shock for atrial fibrillation, sinus tachycardia, or a patient gets a shock for myopotential, patient gets a shock for EMI, electromagnetic interference from microwave oven or from a pump. So everything is inappropriate shock. How to assess those things? This is the inappropriate shock because if the T wave is very tall, like in hyperkalemia and all, it will be equal to the size of the QRS. This ICD will not know which is QRS and which is T wave. It will assess that it will take both and it will take the ventricular fibrillation to the shock. So there are algorithms to change this, to make this ICD insensitive during the time of TV, so that it will capture only the QRS. Next slide. So it will count the RO of the double. If there is intra-articular condition defect, you are 2 hours long, it will count the RO of double. Then it will say ventricular fibrillation, ventricular tachycardia. That also can be taken care of the algorithms. If the connector pin is loose in the CRT, then there will be a lot of noise CM. So this noise will be misinterpreted as ventricular fibrillation, it will give a shock. Next slide. This electromagnetic interval, this is one of the patients who was implanting a pump, some pump here. And at the time we had shock. When he saw the IC loss, there was a lot of noise because of electromagnetic interval. Then we told him not to go here. Next slide. This is the myopotential from diaphragm. So we had to program these, then the sensitivity level higher, that got rid of it. Next slide. This is the atrial tachycardia, which is inappropriate diagnosed as ventricular tachycardia and was stopped. Previously, the atrial tachycardia was not only from conducted, then the ICD was wiser. Next, for after something, the atrial tachycardia was conducted one instrument and the ICD had to stop. Next slide. This is how the algorithm works and what are the parallels of those algorithms. Next slide. So, this is how CRT and ICD, they are not just implantation, there is much more than that. And the algorithms, the company people are evolving day by day, and they are coming up with new algorithms, and there are fallacies for those. You cannot believe just them. They say this algorithm is from you for 3 hours, and you have to sit and see. There are a lot of algorithms which we told them to ask them to take back because of these problems. There are many algorithms.
So, I have a question.
Yes.
It's the same precaution to be applied for any other patient dies and cremated in an electrical crematorium?
Yeah, yes. They are all, they contain batteries. If you are taking the electric crematorium, then definitely the basement will have to be taken off. And it will help a whole patient, of course.
Ordinary MBBS can do it, or an electrophysiologist should come and do it?
Not necessarily. There is one screw to loosen it. If they know how to use the screw, that is more than enough. Just open it, take it out, and without damaging. You can damage the pacemaker and take it out. That's only. If you want to use it for the next 4 patients, then you have to take it a little carefully, unscrew it carefully, take out the lead carefully.
Your team of technicians can do that?
Yes. Very well.
Your hospital emergency is using optical coherence tomography.
Yes.
I want to see how it
works. Optical coherence tomography is not used for electrophysiology. It is used for coronary angiogram and coronary angioplasty. We use it regularly. Our doctor, our colleague, Dr. Nandakumar will be dealing about that.
You have a knee, right?
He has. He will be just showing it to me.